Yes, thanks, James.
So in spectral graph theory is the study of how to use techniques from linear algebra to understand graph theory and to develop graph algorithms. And although as we'll see in this bootcamp, the field is pretty wide, what I will focus in the sequence of three lectures is one particular set of applications, which is to try to see what combinatorial properties of a graph are implied by the numerical values of the eigenvalues of its adjacency matrix and of other matrices related to it. On the more constructive side, several of those properties have algorithmic proofs, and that usually implies that algorithms to solve approximately graph partitioning problems can be obtained by working with the eigenvectors of the adjacency matrix and these other matrices related to the graph. So those algorithms have been used very successfully for a long time. There is pretty good understanding of what happens in random and semi-random models of graphs, for why on those graphs those algorithms work. What I will focus on those three lectures is more of a worst-case approach, where we show what must be true for every graph about the relation between eigenvalues and graph properties, and what must be true for every graph about what you can do given eigenvectors if you want to find approximate cuts by partitions, clustering, and so on. So let's so one way to think about the eigenvalues of the eigenvectors of a matrix is through their definition. So if M is a matrix, then we would say that lambda is an eigenvalue if there exists some, so this is a number, if there exists some vector, this could also be complex value, so it's lambda, such that we have mx equal lambda x. And in this case, x is called an eigenvector of lambda. Now, this definition doesn't make very intuitive the fact that if M is the adjacency matrix of a graph, so it's a matrix that you position ij as a 1 if the graph has an edge between I and j, and 0 otherwise, those numbers should have anything to do with structural or combinatorial properties of the graph. But as we look at other equivalent characterizations of eigenvalues, this will become more transparent. Now, another equivalent way of thinking about eigenvalues, so here x needs to be non-zero, otherwise this is trivial. So another equivalent way of thinking about this equation is that we can think of lambda x like lambda times the identity matrix times x. So this equation is also saying that this equation are equivalent. So lambda is an eigenvalue if and only if there is some non-zero vector that multiplied by m minus lambda times the adjacency matrix gives you 0. Now, the only way a matrix can be such that multiplied by a non-zero vector gives you the 0 vector is if this matrix has determinant 0, because then it cannot be invertible. So this is true if and only if this is true, which holds if and only if this is true. Now here, maybe this equation makes it even less clear why numbers lambda for which this happens should have anything to do with graph properties of with properties of a graph of which M is the adjacency matrix. And in fact, it's almost never useful to start from this definition of eigenvalues to try to get quantitative and combinatorial results. With very important exceptions that Nikhil will talk about later on. But one thing you can get out of this equation is the observation that if you have an n by n matrix, there can be at most n different eigenvalues for that matrix. That's because if you look at the calculation that gives you this determinant given lambda, m is a given matrix, I is the identity, so the only variable here is lambda. The determinant is a polynomial of degree n in the entries of this matrix, and each entry of this matrix depends only on lambda. So this is a polynomial of degree n in lambda. And a polynomial can have at most n roots, so an n by n matrix can have at most n different eigenvalues. Another thing to notice is that that you can get from this definition is that in fact every matrix has eigenvalues, because if you work over the complex numbers, every polynomial has roots. So those are a couple of properties that are not obvious from this definition. So if you look at this, it seems entirely possible that lambda could take infinitely many possible values and this equation be satisfied, or that there could be matrices for which this equation is never satisfied. So those are a couple of things that you get from this perspective. But now, coming to something that will make it more easy to work with graphs, there are special properties of eigenvalues that are true for real symmetric matrices, or in general for Hermitian matrices, but so for us, restricting to real symmetric is enough. So let's say we have a real matrix that is symmetric. And so here the example to keep in mind is the adjacency matrix of an undirected graph. So then it's not hard to prove that all the eigenvalues are real. You can use this equation to show that for every eigenvalue, the eigenvalue has to be equal to its conjugate, so that's only possible for real numbers. Also, from that equation, it's not hard to see that if you have eigenvectors of two different eigenvalues, then they have to be orthogonal. So that's a different way of seeing that there can be at most n eigenvalues. But most importantly, we have the spectral theorem that gives what's called a variational characterization of the eigenvalues, which gives us a way of thinking about eigenvalues as solutions to optimization problems. And now those optimization problems, when m is the adjacency matrix of the graph, they will be very natural graph of optimization problems. And so that's where the connection will come from. So this characterization is the following. If we call, so again, m real symmetric, this is true also if it's complex and Hermitian. So if we call lambda 1 up to lambda n the eigenvalues in non-decreasing order, they're all real, so we can talk about order. And they don't need to be n different numbers, but we can pick each number with multiplicities according to what is the multiplicity with which it solves this equation. So then we have the following properties. That lambda 1 is the maximum over all non-zero vectors of this expression, non-increasing, so it's the minimum. So this expression is summation over ij, mij. If x1 is an optimal solution, then x1 is the is an eigenvector of lambda 1. So then the second smallest eigenvalue, which could be equal to the smallest if there is multiplicity, can be characterized as the minimum over all vectors orthogonal to x1 of the same expression, and so on. So the third smallest eigenvalue will be, and then here x2, every x2 which is optimal is an eigenvector of lambda 2. So this will be the way of thinking about eigenvalues that would be useful to relate them to graph problems, so as solutions of optimization problems. In fact, what will be the theme of this series of lectures is to think about those eigenvalues thus characterized. So those are optimization problems over real vectors. So those are solutions to continuous optimization problems. What we will think about is of what combinatorial problem are this optimization problem a relaxation. And so then we will see there are very natural graph problems whose natural relaxation to a convex optimization becomes something like this. And so then to study the relation between eigenvalues and these combinatorial problems, what we need to understand is what kind of integrality gap there is between this continuous relaxation and the combinatorial graph problem. So those integrity gaps can be studied by rounding algorithms. So the traditional proofs, but they can be seen as analyzing certain rounding algorithms for relaxations. So this is the point of view that we'll take in these lectures. Okay. So what metrics we want to compute the eigenvalues of? So one possibility is the addition symmetrics. But there is a slight modification of the addition symmetrics that makes this expression, x transpose mx divided by x transpose x, much more transparently a relaxation of a cut problem. So we're going to define the following matrix. So at first, for simplicity, let's say we have a graph G. It has to be undirected, otherwise the corresponding matrix will not be symmetric. So then the whole characterization will fail. And for simplicity, for now, let's say that it's regular. Although there is a way to adjust all the definitions and all the proofs so that they work for irregular graphs. So we're going to define the following matrix. This will be called the normalized Laplacian of the graph. So this is the identity minus 1 over the degree times the adjacent symmetrix. So this matrix will be 1 on the diagonal and minus 1 over d for the edges and 0 otherwise. So this matrix is sort of reverse engineered so that when you look at that expression x transpose matrix x, you get something that really looks like a cut problem. So you can do the calculation and see that when you look at this expression, what you're going to get is the summation twice the summation over all the edges of xu minus xv squared divided by the degree times the summation over v of xv squared. So here, a vector is just some way of assigning real numbers to vertices. And that expression that defines the eigenvalues It's something that says how much this vector changes across edges, scaled by its norm. So this quantity will be small for vectors that tend to have almost the same values for all coordinates ij that correspond to an edge ij. And this will be very large for vectors where, when you look at the coordinates ij corresponding to the endpoints of an edge, you'll tend to see that the value for I is roughly minus the value for j. So vectors that minimize this tend to correspond to relaxations of sparse cuts, and vectors that maximize this tend to correspond to relaxations of max cuts. And so that's what we'll try to argue. All right, so let's start by looking at the eigenvalues of the Laplacian of a graph. So lambda 1 will be the minimum over all non-zero x of this. So what can we say about lambda 1? Well, certainly lambda 1 will be greater than or equal to 0, because it's a ratio of squares. So then the other thing is, how can we make this value as small as possible? Well, you can see that if we pick a vector that is a constant, meaning a vector that has the same value in every coordinate, then all those differences will be 0. So the whole numerator will be 0. And that's the least that you can have. So that will be an optimal solution. So this corresponds to sort of thinking that if you have a graph and you want to say, well, what is a set of vertices that has the fewest edges coming out? Well, all the edges will work. Sorry, all the vertices will work. So that's maybe not a very interesting calculation. But then you can say, well, what is the second smallest eigenvalue of the Laplacian? So this, so now we're minimizing. Maybe I'll write over there. Now we are minimizing over non-zero vectors that sum to 0. So that's what it means to be orthogonal to whatever solution we found before. The solution we found before was all ones. So being orthogonal means that the entries sum to 0 of this. So now we can ask, is 0 a multiplicity? So is it possible for this eigenvalue to be also 0? So that's the smallest possible value that you can take. Well, for lambda 2 to be also 0, it means that there has to be some vector with those properties. So the sum of the entries has to be 0, such that the numerator is 0, which is sum of squares. So every entry in the sum of squares needs to be 0. So there has to be some vector such that for every edge, xu is equal to xv. So let's see for a moment what this means. By induction, this means that such a vector needs to have the same value on all the entries that correspond to vertices which are on a path. Like if you have a path, for every edge, the two entries corresponding to the endpoints of the edge must have the same value. Do it along a path, the endpoints of the path must have the same value. So that means that in every quantity component, this vector x must give must have the same value in the two entries corresponding to any two vertices in that quantity component. But now, this vector is non-zero but sums to zero, which means that it has strictly positive values in some entries and strictly negative values in some other entries. So the graph cannot be connected, because there cannot be any path from the vertices that correspond to positive entries to the vertices that correspond to negative entries. So already, the existence of such an X clearly implies that the graph is disconnected. But it's not hard to see it the other way around. You can start by, if you have two quantity components, you can give value plus 1 to the vertex in one component and minus 1 to the others. So then the vector will not be all 0, and this property is true. Okay, so this property will not be true, because if you have plus 1 in one component, minus 1 in the other, the two components don't have the same size, doesn't add up to 0. So just scale things appropriately. So the vertices in one component give them a value which is the number of vertices of the other component. So now things will add up to 0. Right, so you already see some non-trivial connection between the eigenvalues of the Laplacian and purely combinatorial properties of the graph. Like, you compute the eigenvalues, you see what's the multiplicity of 0. If you see any non-trivial multiplicity, the graph must be disconnected. And that's an if and only. So already connectivity is related to the eigenvalues. In fact, you can say more. So there's another way of looking at characterizations of higher eigenvalues. So one is through this sort of iterative procedure that says, solve this optimization problem, then take your solution, and now solve the optimization problem again, but only for vectors orthogonal to the previous solution. And then solve it again, but only for vectors orthogonal to the first two solutions, and so on. So that's a way of thinking of what is lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, and so on. But there is an equivalent way where you can see it as a min-max problem. So you can say that lambda k is also the minimum over all k-dimensional subspaces S of the maximum for non-zero elements of the space of this expression. It's called the Rayleigh quotient. So instead of having a characterization where you can keep using whatever you found previously, you can sort of define it all at once. So the 2D meaning here is to say that, so lambda k, under what condition it's small? It's small if there are vectors that make this quantity small. But not just some vector. There has to be a k-dimensional way of choosing vectors that make this small. And so the precise thing is, so lambda k is less than epsilon if and only if you can find a k-dimensional way of choosing vectors for which this is always a epsilon. So now, back to the case of the Laplacian. So that means that this is how you can think of lambda k. So this is the minimum over k-dimensional ways of picking vectors of the worst case of this ratio over the way in which we pick vectors. So now let's redo the argument from before, but more generally. So we can say, well, is it possible for lambda k to be 0? So is there a lot of multiplicity for 0? Well, for this to be true, there has to be a k-dimensional space S such that for every non-zero vector in S, in fact, for every vector in S, and for every edge of the graph, the endpoints need to be equal. So that just applying this characterization to the special case of the Laplacian. To the fact that you said before, that if you have a vector for which this ratio is zero, that vector must be such that for every edge, the endpoints must have the same value. Otherwise, some of those squares would be strictly positive, and so the whole expression would not be zero. All right, so what? So let's see it in this direction. So what happens when lambda k is zero? That we can find, so we can find some space of vectors such that every vector in this space is constant in each connected component. And this space is k-dimensional. Well, this must mean that the graph must have at least k connected components, because the only degrees of freedom that we have in choosing a space S for which this property is true is that we are free to choose what constant value to give in each component. As soon as we do anything else, we are out of this condition. But if you have a k-dimensional space and the only degrees of freedom comes to picking k constants, I mean, to pick as many constants as the number of connected components, the number of connected components must be more than k. And the same goes in the other direction. If you have k connected components, you can define S to be the space of all vectors that are constant in each component. By definition, this will be k-dimensional. And this will be a witness that lambda k is zero. So this is a more general connection between eigenvalues and connectivity. This is saying that the number of times the zero occurs as an eigenvalue is precisely the number of connected components of the graph. Okay, so this also means that in that polynomial, the determinant of Laplacian minus lambda times the adjacency matrix, there is going to be some way to factor the polynomial out with a term of lambda to the k, if and only if the graph has k connected components. So I don't know if there's any way to look at it directly in terms of those polynomials, but so this proof makes it very transparent. So what we'll talk about more in those lectures is what kind of how robust are those results. So here we're saying that lambda k is zero if and only if the graph can be divided into k connected components. What happens when lambda k is small? Can we find k subset of vertices such that in some sense they are approximately disconnected from each other? So then this will have so this would be a way to think about clustering algorithms in this language. But before getting to the to those robustness results that will occupy us for a while, I want to just briefly look at the other end of the spectrum and see how can we think of the largest eigenvalue of the Laplacian, because that's also an optimization problem. And like, this is a problem where you're looking for some of the Boolean equivalent is that we're looking for a cut with no edges. So on the other end of the spectrum, this will have to correspond to looking for a cut with lots of edges. All right, so let's see just what the definitions are giving us. Okay, so let's look at lambda n. So lambda n is like the smallest eigenvalue of, it's minus the smallest eigenvalue of minus the Laplacian. So we can work out through the spectral theorem. And so this will be just the maximum for non-zero vectors of the Rayleigh quotient. So so now it's convenient to just slightly rewrite things. Well, first of all, maybe now it's a place to think of like what is a combinatorial problem of which this is a convex relaxation. So if we turn this into a Boolean problem, a natural way is to just think of not all vectors, but all Boolean vectors. So let's think of what is this Boolean problem? So going in the opposite direction, which we normally think about optimization, like normally we have some combinatorial problem, and then we say, well, how can we get the relaxation of it? Here we think, well, here there is this natural continuous problem coming from this theory. Or can we think of it as the relaxation of something? So if we just look at the Boolean axis, so what do we get? Well, those Boolean axes are just describing cuts. Alright, so in the denominator, if every entry of x is plus minus 1, all the squares are 1. So this is d times n. Alright, so what happens in the numerator? Alright, so for every edge, we are counting it as 0 if both endpoints are both in S or both outside of S. Like if it's not cut by the partition S, V minus S. So if they're both plus 1 or both minus 1. If they're different signs, which means that one endpoint is in S and one endpoint is outside of S, so it's plus 1 minus minus 1 or minus 1 minus plus 1. So then we count it 4 times because it becomes 2 squared. So let's write it this way. The number of edges with one endpoint in S and one endpoint in V minus S. So D times N is twice the number of edges in a regular graph. So what we're getting is 4 times the max cut of G. Why am I not getting 2?
Because of the
fact that you should have had a half.
You win the expression of the last year, the original one.
This was a half, it wasn't 2.
It was a half.
It should have changed to a 4.
Yes. All right, because when I open up the summation, I get I always get 2 xu minus xv.
Should not even be
enough. No.
That should be a 2. You didn't erase the 2 when you said it became a 4. So it looks like, in fact, 24.
No, there is a dot.
But you weren't there 2 times 4? This should be 4.
Okay. No, sorry, but see, this is the right way of writing the real equation. When you open up. You have D in the denominator. So when you open up.
Actually, your sum is over an ordered pair.
Yeah.
Over unordered pairs, yes. Yeah. So this will be the summation over the edges of minus 2 xu xv. And then there is going to be d summation over v of xv squared. And that's precisely d x transpose x. We can see it like this, minus x transpose ax. So that's because, okay, so this is what it is. Here, there is this 2, but I'm summing over edges, while this expression sums over ordered pairs ij, which are edges, so every edge is counted twice here, and it's also correctly counted twice here. Okay, great. So so we don't have the 2. And so this is right. So lambda n is, there will be many other factors of 2 that I get wrong in the next 3 hours. But I think now we got it right. So lambda n will be, if you do the opposite of relaxing it, so if you restrict it to be an optimization problem over Boolean vectors, what you get is twice the max cut of G. Where by max cut we mean normalized by the edges. So what fraction of edges participate in the max cut? So what really is so interesting says, well, let's compute the eigenvalues of the Laplacian. We see that lambda n is bounded away from 2. So that means that the graph is not bipartite. In fact, it means a possibly useful upper bound on what the max cut can be. Okay, so in fact, this is already proving that if lambda n is equal to 2, that if G is bipartite, then this implies that lambda n is 2. Because G being bipartite means that there is a cut that cuts all the edges, so the max cut of the graph would be 2. Lambda n can be only bigger, so at the very least we have established that. Okay, so now let's see more what the expression is going to look like. So we said lambda n is the true lambda n, not this inverse relaxation, is the maximum over all non-zero vectors. No. Depends on whether G is connected or not. Right, so let's look at the true expression. So already by calculations that we... So I want to write it in the following way. So this summation of, so I want to use the following identity. So I'm going to use this identity. You can just verify it by saying that if I adapt this square with this square, the cross products will cancel out and I just get twice the square of xu plus twice the square of xv. So I'll use that in the numerator. So that will give me, for each edge, will give me 2xu squared plus 2xv squared. So this gives me 2d summation over v of xv squared. And then minus, and then I have the sum over the edges. Instead of being xu minus xv, now I have xu plus xv. I think that's a little bit easier to think about this way. And then summation of xv squared. This is a bit like passing from max cut to the problem of minimizing uncut edges. And so this is 2 minus the minimum When we write it this way, now we can figure out what's going on with lambda n, because this is telling us that lambda n is at most 2, because it's 2 minus some expression, which is a ratio of squares. So very similarly, like before, we proved that lambda 1 had to be at least 0, because it was optimizing some ratio of squares. Now, for lambda n to be equal to 2, so this can happen if and only if there is some vector x such that for every edge uv, when we look at the coordinate for xu and the coordinate for xv, they are identical in absolute value, but they are 1 minus the other. Okay? Because that's the only way for all those squares to be equal to 0. Right, so in a graph, the biggest eigenvalue of the Laplacian attains its extremal value if and only if there is some vector such that when we look at every edge, we see the corresponding entries in the vector to be a and minus a. So it seems now this means that this can happen if and only if the graph is bipartite, but there is a catch, that if the graph is disconnected, and one of the connected components is bipartite, you can still make this to be 2. Because what you do is, so let's say that your graph looks like this. So that what I can do is to say, OK, this is all going to be 0. And this is going to be plus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1. Right, so this is a non-zero vector. And when I go and compute this expression, I get 2, because this whole part cancels out. Right, in this component, every difference is every sum, I guess, is 0 because everything is 0. Here, every sum is 0 because I have this bipartition. So if if G has a bipartite connected component, then lambda n is 2. This is something we can do for every graph in which at least one of the quantity components is bipartite. And we can also see that the converse is true. Because suppose someone gives us a vector with this kind of property. Right? It's an assignment of real numbers to every vertex. And then for every edge, the endpoints of the edge are of this form, a minus a. So if the vector is non-zero, some entry needs to be non-zero. So let's look at this vertex that has a non-zero value. So then what happens? So let's say this vertex has some value a. Now all its neighbors are going to have value minus a. And all the neighbors of the neighbors must have value plus a. Right? So and every reachable vertex must have value either plus a or minus a. So when you look at the quantity component that that vertex belongs to, every vertex in that quantity component gets value plus a or minus a. And if you look at the bipartition of that quantity component according to sign, you'll see that all the edges of that quantity component cross that bipartition. And so this is a characterization of when lambda n takes its extremal value. So it's slightly less clean than what we have in the low energy setting. But say, if you assume connectivity, then you have this equivalence with bipartiteness. Okay, so now we have all these extremal results that say, you know, what's the smallest value that lambda 2 could have? It's 0. When does it happen? Precisely when the graph is disconnected. What's the largest value the lambda n could take? It's 2. When does it happen in this case? So now we want to pass to robust versions of this and say, you know, what happens if lambda n is 1.999? Or what happens if lambda 5 is 0.001? Is there some sense in which we can recover results of this type? And so the point will be, now we can already sort of see that if here, instead of having arbitrary vectors, we had Boolean vectors, we're looking at kind of well-defined graph problems. And so in getting those robust connections, what we will need to do is to say, well, now we have a fractional solution of this relaxation. How do we get a Boolean solution that has comparable value? And that's also why those structural results, they just say, well, how the eigenvalues relate to graph properties, they can always be seen as analysis of approximation algorithms. And if those approximation algorithms are used kind of independently of those analyses, what we're doing is kind of catching up to analyze what those algorithms are doing in the worst case. Okay, so starting from lambda 2, let's look again at what kind of problem lambda 2 is a relaxation of. Okay, so lambda 2, we said, was this minimum over non-zero vectors whose entries sum to 0 Okay, now it turns out that we get the same result if we optimize something that looks a little different in the denominator. Here we're going to sum over ordered pairs. And maybe we'll divide by 2. Do we divide by 2? No, we don't divide by 2.
You're summing over ordered or unordered?
Ordered.
Ordered.
Yeah. The one, yeah, I guess I want to divide by 2.
So, Luca, if you didn't use the Laplacian and you just use the adjacency matrix, you would have a cleaner formulation for the most negative eigenvalues by part tightness, right?
I think I would still want to get to here. I would want to write the most negative eigenvalue as 1 minus an expression like this. I mean, to me, the most negative way to argue about lambda n is that there is something, and then there is a ratio of squares. And then I want to say, well, in the extremal case, this ratio of squares to be 0.
But if you don't normalize, it should be the case that if you have eigenvalue minus d, even only if it's by part tightness.
No.
Ah.
I mean, look at this. If you look at the adjacency matrix, it is an eigenvector of eigenvalue minus 2. I mean, there can be no difference. So the eigenvalues are the same, they're just shifted. Okay. So when we want to rewrite things this way. So why is this a valid way of rewriting things? It's just that when you sum over all the ordered pairs, so you're going to get 2n times all the squares, and then you're going to get twice all the cross products. But then when we look at this summation of cross products, that's just the same as looking at the summation of the all squared. And we are optimizing over vectors for which the summation of V is 0. So for vectors such that the summation of the entries is 0, one way that in this case is convenient to think about the norm square of the vector is as this kind of random difference between entries. So you look at all possible entries, see what's the difference squared, and that gives you the same result up to scaling. Okay. But now, this condition that V has to sum to 0, if we write the cost function like this, it's unnecessary. Because if you have any solution, and you just add the same cost and value to every entry, you're not changing the cost function. Because if you add a fixed constant to every entry, that fixed constant will always cancel. So if you have an arbitrary solution to this problem, you can always make the entry sum to 0 by subtracting the average value to every entry. And that will not change the cost function. So now it's a little bit more it's a bit easier to think about because we don't have this condition anymore. We're just saying we take any vector, so label the vertices by real numbers, and then what's the average difference squared along edges, and then what's the average distance squared between random pairs. Well, then lambda 2 can be small if and only if you can find a vector for which the average distance squared along edges is much smaller than the average distance squared between random pairs. I'm calling it distance because one way to think about those vectors is that they are mapping vertices to the line. And so what you're looking here is what is the distance of two vertices in this embedding on the line.
But you still have to exclude x's for which all their entries are equal, because then the expression is undefined.
Okay, so you can say in that case the value is, by convention, it's 0. If you end up with 0 divided by 0, then you say in that case it's 0.
It's 1. You don't want it to be the minimum. You don't want it to be the minimum.
It is. Zero. Oh, sorry. You're right. So, yeah, x is non-constant. What?
It's not equal to 0, and it has to sum to 0.
No, that
not equal to 0. So, in particular, x is non-constant. In particular, that rules out being 0. Or I guess if you get 0 divided by 0, then that's infinity. So I was talking before about averages, because in fact, when you follow the normalizations, that's also equivalent. Kind of takes care automatically of the factors of 2. So now I guess lambda 2 is starting to make a lot of sense. We are saying, so is there some way of mapping the vertices on the line so that the average distance squared between endpoints of edges is much smaller than the average distance squared of random pairs? So lambda 2 is whatever is the minimum way of getting this ratio. Okay, so now we can do the exercise of thinking what combinatorial problem relaxes to lambda 2 when we think of lambda 2 in this way. Well, let's look at the same problem, but in the Boolean case. So we're going to look at the minimum over all Boolean x. non-constant. Of this expectation over edges divided by the expectation over pairs. Right, so if we have a Boolean vector, that's defining a cut in the graph, partition the vertex into two parts. And here, after normalization, we are counting how many edges cross the cut. And here, after normalization, we're looking at how many pairs of vertices are separated by the cut. So this is the minimum over all non-trivial cuts of the number of edges with one endpoint in S and one endpoint not in S divided by the product of S times V minus S, normalized in the right way. So this needs to be divided by 1 over E. This needs to be divided by V squared over 2. So 1 over E is, I think D over N is the right normalization. N over D. Times divided by 2. So this is a well-studied problem. This is called the uniform sparse cut. Of Jin. So lambda 2 is a relaxation of this problem. And the eigenvector of lambda 2 is a fractional solution for this problem. So what? So let's call this the, let's define this to be uniform sparse cut of G. So what we will explore in the next hour, among other things, is that, but we will say it with respect to a slightly different combinatorial problem. But what's true for the uniform sparse cut is that, so being a relaxation, this is smaller than lambda 2. But also, it's at most square root of 8 uniform sparse cut. So it's not saying that we can think of lambda 2 as being a constant factor computable approximation of the uniform sparse cut, but it is saying that the qualitatively, the graphs in which the sparse cut is small are precisely the graphs in which lambda 2 is small. And like in many graphs, one doesn't get this kind of worst case, but certainly in every graph, one has a kind of relationship of this type. We'll also see some graphs for which this inequality is tight and some graphs for which this is tight. But the, also the important thing is that, okay, so this inequality is just pretty much by definition.
Okay.
I got the wrong directions, right?
USC and lambda 2 be interchanged in the inequality?
Yeah, because lambda 2 is a relaxation of a minimization problem, so it has to be smaller. So this inequality is by definition because lambda 2 is a relaxation of this minimization problem, so the optimum can only be smaller. So, but the important thing is that this direction has a constructive proof in the following sense. That if x is an eigenvector of lambda 2, then there is a vertex v such that the cut, so let's call it maybe T because it acts as a threshold. such that if I look at the cut defined by all the vertices that the eigenvector makes smaller than t, and all the vertices that the eigenvector makes bigger than t, the next t, this is a solution of uniform sparse cut that has cost at most the square root of 8 lambda 2. So it's not just that there is some argument that proves this upper bound, but this upper bound, also it's not that just this upper bound applies to the true combinatorial optimum. This upper bound applies to the solution that you can find in polynomial, in fact, nearly linear time, by finding even an approximate eigenvector, and then trying all possible ways of deriving a cut from it by saying, well, let's, you know, this eigenvector is an embedding of vertices on the line, so let's break up the line arbitrarily in all possible ways as an initial segment and then the following vertices. There are only n ways of doing that. One of them is going to give you this type of approximation. Now, by the easy direction, this is at most the square root of 8 times the combinatorial optimum. So this is saying that here is something you can compute in nearly linear time, and it's going to have a small cost function if the optimum is small. So it's not constant factor approximation, but at least this is saying if there is a very good cut, you will find a somewhat good cut. OK, James, I can stop here for now.
Questions? All right, we'll have plenty of time for questions during the break. And Nikhil speaks in half an hour.
In half an hour.